building great experiences. He helps scale Twilio and Ship and currently runs a software consultancy. Kevin once accidentally left Waiting for Godot at the intermission. When he was young, Kevin was voted most likely to succeed at Ultimate Mini Golf Olympics. So let's give it up for Kevin.
I'm going to be talking about Feral Concurrency, which is a paper by Peter Bayliss and four co-authors. I'm really excited to get into it, so let's get right into it. A lot of the talks that come here involve larger groups of machines and distributed coordination and distributed locking and availability and all this stuff. In this talk, we're going to be looking at a single primary database and writing SQL commands like a transactional database like Postgres or MySQL, maybe with some replicas, in an application where the sole goal is to get data into the database as correctly and as quickly as possible, right? But none of these sort of multi-master setups that a lot of bigger systems have. Just one database, and you want to get the data in as well as you can. So what happens when you create a user in Rails, right? Let's say we have a Rails app that talks to a Postgres database, and we want to create new users in that system, right? I have a demo Rails app here. It is the world's smallest Rails app. It has a single user. The user has an email address, and that email address has a uniqueness constraint on it. So in Rails, we want to validate, ooh, that's not big enough. In Rails, we want to validate that the email address, no two users have the same email address, right? So what happens when we actually do this in the console? I'm going to create a user, create email test at example.com, and we hit enter, and Rails is this really nice thing where it prints out the SQL that's running, and it prints out the amount of time that SQL took to run, which I highly recommend no matter what ORM or application you're using, that you figure out how to enable this on your computer, how to tail the database logs. It's the easiest way to figure out when something goes wrong, what is going wrong, or when you're not quite sure what's going on. It's definitely the easiest way to see what's going on is just by tailing the database logs and seeing what SQL queries are actually being generated. But Rails really helpfully inserts this right onto the screen for us. So you can see there's four queries here, right? There's a, we're beginning a transaction. We are selecting from the database. We're trying to find whether there are any users in the database already that have this email address. If that returns zero users, then we're going to insert a record. If that insert goes well, then we're going to commit the transaction. So we're issuing four queries against the database. And you'll notice Rails isn't sending those as part of one prepared statement. It's four round trips to the database. So begin is a round trip, then select is a round trip, then insert is a round trip, commit is a round trip. If your database is on a different machine or in a different data center, this can add a lot of latency to your application, especially if you're doing a lot of creates or you're not able to run in a threaded environment. It can add a lot of latency to your application. So as I pointed out, this is slow. The surprising thing is it's also incorrect, right? You can actually end up in a scenario where you have two users with the same email address in the database, right? So you might be wondering how that can happen, right? That looked pretty good. Those four queries look pretty good, but how can we end up in a state where we have two users in the database with the same email address? One thing really fast is, it is a bad thing to have multiple users with the same email address in the database. Imagine you get an incoming email and then you want to find a user based on it and take some action. It's not clear which account you're going to choose, or you have login based on email, or you have a session cookie that is email based or username based, and you have different accounts that share the same thing that's supposed to be unique. You might get either one of those or split the data across them, or all kinds of bad stuff can happen. So you don't want to have this happen, and Rails kind of lets you do this by default. So the how of this and sort of the discovery here was the focus of the paper. the five people that wrote the paper are database experts. They're sort of academic people, and they're looking at it from a database perspective and saying, well, we've built all these nice tools for people to manage concurrency and write data in a consistent manner, and how well are applications, web applications, using this? In particular, they focused on Rails applications, but we'll get into that in a minute. But the how of it is this four query loop that you use in Rails. This begin, select, insert, commit is not safe at the read committed database isolation level. I don't have time to go into database isolation levels, unfortunately. There are several of them. Read committed is one of them. They go from serializable is the most consistent and kind of the slowest, and then down through the list until you get to read committed. So you say, okay, well, maybe we could run it at a better transaction level where it's actually safe to run this. The problem is that most databases default to read committed out of the box, and Rails also doesn't change the isolation level, so they could actually run that create statement at a higher isolation level, but they don't. So most people by default, unless you're really motivated, you're not going to change this, and you're going to be vulnerable to a duplicate record insert. Another thing not in the paper is some Rails functions will skip the validations. So if you define validations in your model, these 12, I think, methods listed here will all skip those validations and just dump the data straight into the database. Also, if you have any kind of script that's writing SQL or running in a different language and not using those Rails validations, you can kind of skip it and write bad data straight to the database, right? Which is a consistency problem, right? And it's a consistency problem in your application. It's not good. Yeah.
Is that all right?
Yeah.
Okay. So when Rails does its commit, it does begin something something commit. So is that not happening within a transaction on that connection?
It is. It is happening within a transaction, yeah.
Can you repeat that?
The question was the four queries there, are they happening in a transaction? And the answer is yes, they are all happening on the same transaction.
So they're not sufficiently isolated somehow?
Yeah. So I'm not sure the exact specifics of it, but it happens if you insert two records in a short period of time, or you have a lot of threads going. I'd encourage you to read the paper to see the details. Unfortunately, I only have a small amount of time, and I can't get into the whole details. The correct way to actually insert the data is also faster, which is the really interesting thing that we're going to get into really fast. And I'll show you a demo of how to do this. For this one, we're going to use the Postgres REPL. So here we have a database schema for users. We have ID and email, and then two timestamp values. And the correct way to do this is with a database constraint in the database, right? So I'm going to alter this table, users, add constraint, unique email key, unique on email. And now what happens is if I try to insert into users, ID, email, values, let's say 8, and test2@example.com. This should succeed, right? Like this one is not unique. But now if we repeat the same query, we get a duplicate key violation. Basically, this is the database telling us you can't do this because this record already exists and it fails my constraint. And the value here is you can do this with just one query, right? And there's no way to work around this, right? The 12 Rails functions that skip the validations in memory will still run into this database constraint. The one person on your team that runs a script in Go over the weekend because they want to learn Go will also run into this constraint, right? Like they can't screw up your database by doing that, right? And it's correct, right? There's no way to circumvent this, right? Unless your database is really, really, really screwed up, which the MySQL and Postgres and SQLite are not. So the question is, why do ORM authors prefer the slow way with four queries instead of doing the fast way with one query? The incorrect way that is slower instead of the faster way that is also more correct, right? Like why do ORM authors like the slow way? Let's look at the example code if they wanted to implement the faster correct way. we have some code, a pseudocode to create a user with email equals one, and then we have to handle, for every database that we could possibly write to, we have to handle that database specific exception, right? So we have to handle a SQLite error, and then we have to parse that error and figure out how SQLite represents uniqueness constraint failures, right? And then we have to do the same for MySQL and for Postgres and for Mongo and for RocksDB and for whatever else that we're using or could possibly write to. We have to figure out how to parse those constraint failures, right? So that could be a burden on the ORM developer. Contrast that with the Rails way, where you kind of can implement, create on top of building blocks that you already have, right? So we already have a find method. You can find a user, you get a user object in memory. If you have a user object, you can throw an error. That's easy, that you only have to write that one time. If you don't have a user, then you create, and then you commit the transaction, right? So this is easier and a little bit more flexible to use and to deal with, which is why I think a lot of ORM developers end up in this bucket, even though it's less correct and slower. Another bad ORM pattern along the lines of being slower and less correct is reading a value from the database, checking some properties on it, and then issuing an update or updating some of the properties and then calling save on it, right? So I used to work at an on-demand logistics company. We had to assign pickups to a driver. Here's some pseudocode for doing that. You find a pickup if the pickup is in a draft state, and we're checking this in memory on an in-memory Ruby object. Let's assign a driver to the pickup, and then change the pickup's driver ID, change the state to assigned, and then call save. And then save issues an update against the database and updates some fields, and we're off to the races. The problem is we are vulnerable to races, a different type of race. If we look at the query again and imagine that two threads are operating on the same pickup at the same time, the top line, both of them fetch the pickup in a draft state. Both of them check that the state is draft. Both of them try to assign a driver. In our case, assigning drivers involved making a query to Google Maps, so 200 milliseconds of latency or so to get directions to wherever they were trying to go. Both of them are going to update the driver ID. Both of them are going to update the state to assigned, and then both of them are going to save the pickup, right? So you're going to end up in a situation where two drivers are assigned to the same pickup, which was our number one cause of on-call incidents. And you might say, well, this might, you know, yeah, this could theoretically happen, but it can't happen that much, but it might happen more often than you think. For us, we had an iOS client that would submit pickups twice within 5 milliseconds. It would send the same request two times within 5 milliseconds of each other, so that was two threads coming in and doing this and assigning it. So the better way to do this is to issue a single update and guard it with a where clause, right? I recommend that you implement this for any sort of state machine that you have in your code base, or any time you need to transition an object between states, guard that with a where clause, right? So in this case, we're saying update where the pickup's ID matches this ID and the state is in draft, set it to assigned. If I issue 100 of these at the exact same instant, the database will only ever return one row once, right? Every other time you update, you'll get back zero rows, and then this way you can sort of guard against double transitions, right? Or you can imagine double invoicing a customer, or double assignment in our case, which involves some poor driver in Chicago getting stuck out in the field and having to call in and say, hi, please fix this for me. So in general, I'd recommend staying away from the save property and manipulating objects in memory and then later writing those objects back to the database. Instead, try to focus more on the SQL that you're writing. It's going to be more correct and it's going to be faster. You're going to write fewer SQL queries if you're not manipulating objects in memory. But again, it's about flexibility for ORM developers. It's a lot more flexible to manipulate these objects, and you can put fancy methods on them and all kinds of stuff. Okay, back to the paper really fast. So they looked at 67 different Rails projects, open source Rails projects, 30 models per project. Most of the consistency checks, like uniqueness, not null constraints, validation, like you gave it an integer when it's expecting an integer, were in the application. Foreign keys, same thing, are all in the application in Rails. And little use of the sort of traditional, at least from a database perspective, concurrency control mechanisms like transactions or locking. Here's an example application spree. It's like a shopping cart, I think open source shopping cart application. Here are some places that they use transactions, right? Canceling an order, approving an order. They use 6 transactions in total across the entire project. Here are some places that they didn't have transactions on placing an order or setting the available stock. And it didn't really seem clear, or it didn't really seem like there was a pattern other than how rigorous was the original library author willing to be at this particular place in the code base. There was also a great Chesterton's Fence example where there was a GitHub issue where they had an optimistic lock in place that was checking that this object hadn't been updated since the last time you read it. And it threw errors because someone else had updated the object, and so it was throwing errors and saying, well, you can't update this because someone else actually updated it. And someone complained, and then they said, well, I think we should get rid of it since there's no documentation about why it's there, right? Which is the exact opposite of when you would want to get rid of something. If you don't know why it's there, you don't want to get rid of it until you actually understand what it's doing. There are other hilarious examples in the paper of ORMs not really doing justice to database consistency that I'd encourage you to read. Conclusion. Okay, so how am I doing on time? Okay, I guess. Okay. So for 30 years, database experts have been saying, well, here's all of these great tools that you can use, and we've been working really, really hard to make sure that we can store your data, and you can have multiple versions and concurrency control, and we can store all these different versions simultaneously, and you can have transactions and other stuff going on. And then Rails is saying, you know, like, we don't really need to use any of that. We've got our own thing, and we're kind of going to go with that. And I think there's a broader lesson here about expertise and the value of expertise and the benefits of actually listening to experts versus doing it your own way. And then also about sort of experts needing to provide advice and provide sort of libraries and tools that fit with users' patterns and are adapted for sort of the way that we're building applications nowadays. So the lesson from the code snippets that I showed and from the Rails way of doing things, they really value cross-database flexibility, right? It's really valuable to say one interface for 7 different data stores, right? If you're an ORM author and you can sort of do that without necessarily needing to know the specifics of every single database and provide O of N error handling for every database that you implement. So there's an opportunity here. If you are a database library author, you consider maybe there's some sort of opportunity for a cross database interface that does a lot of common things that you do in web applications, right? So you can imagine some like shared header, right? Like a lot of the database queries that people write for web applications are pretty simple, right? Create a record, find a record, update a record, you know, delete a record, right? Like that's it. There's not that much. Sure, there are exceptions, but in the 95% cases is just those 3 applications, those 4. And then error handling, right? Like checking whether a resource is null, checking whether a resource already exists, checking whether it violates a foreign key constraint. If you just cover those cases across every database, it's possible. We could provide that consistency to ORM developers while still making it easy for them to have this sort of cross-database support, right? If you can imagine some sort of shared interface, right? And here's an example. If I want to check for a unique constraint failure in Postgres, that is code 23,505. In MySQL, it's 1,169. SQLite, it's code 2,067, right? These are all published in the appendix if you read through the database documentation. So you kind of have to dig this out, right, and check against it. But what if there was some new error handling interface where the database could throw at every database implementation implemented the same sort of error specification, right? Every database implemented the same kind of consistency API for ORMs. That's one way to solve it, right? Learn to evaluate ORMs, right? So let's be more critical and let's be more thoughtful about what we look for in an ORM and whether an ORM meets our needs, and can we encourage this ORM to get better or offer more consistent versions, right? The first thing I do when I look at a new ORM is write a user create query and see what SQL it generates, right? Does it generate 4 queries like Rails, or does it generate 1 like SQL Alchemy does? And I encourage you to do the same as well. Same with foreign keys. How does it handle if a table links to another table? Is that implemented in the database, or is that implemented in the application with the same select from the other table, right? If it's in the application, it's probably vulnerable to the same flaw as I demonstrated earlier, and the paper covers that as well. Finally, check the error handling, right? If you do implement database constraints, the ORM might not handle it, or it might make it really gnarly to parse the error back out, which is the meat, the thing that you actually want. So check how it handles that, right? Check how that error information is surfaced to you. Use ORMs better, right? So use your database, right? Use database constraints. Even if the ORM doesn't really support it, you'll like it because it will help you guarantee the consistency of your data. And you won't be surprised when Rails does something funky that you're not expecting. Use updates with a where clause, right? Don't just call save blindly. This is a little bit more controversial, but I found that a lot of the times ORMs sort of paper over the differences and the cool things that make databases really cool, and a lot of the sort of benefits that all these different databases have been working towards. They kind of paper over that and give you one API, but you lose a lot of the good stuff that's specific to that database, right? So one of the reasons people use ORMs is to say, well, we might want to switch our database later. And if you give up on that, you can get more consistent results. If you give up on that dream of one day switching data stores and using the same ORM, you can probably get better, more consistent results and better performance out of your web application. Thanks very much. This is my consulting website. I'm available for consulting, and I'm happy to take your questions.
Questions?
Hello. So here you covered the situation where you have the database, a single database, right? But what if we have like a set of microservices with each managing its own database, and the foreign key constraints are just not there, and you have to manage them at the application level? Are there any research on that, any tips or tricks?
Yeah, that is a really hard question that you should ask Caitie, who has a ton of experience with distributed transactions and partial failure and partial availability. Sorry, I just It's a very complex problem, and hopefully we'll get some. So stay tuned. Stick around, as they say. Are you a plant? Were you just leading into the? Oh, okay.
Okay. So does the paper talk about like whether these mistakes in these Rails applications are made because the authors of those libraries just weren't aware of these techniques, or were they aware of them and they just decided not to bother with them?
Does that the paper talk about that at all? Good question. I don't know. I really don't know. I mean, people have raised the subject on the Rails issue list, and the general response has been use the database index and we're not going to fix the active record behavior. I think it's a more deliberate decision to sort of keep everything in the application. So yeah, I would say yeah. Maybe they weren't aware specifically of how bad it can get in scenarios where you might be inserting or issuing multiple requests with the same data at the same time. That was sort of the main gist of the research in this paper was, excuse me, here's how bad the problem can get in these scenarios, but I don't know.
You called out the database experts and the Rails developer, but what about the database implementers, which default to read committed, which is clearly not the mental model that most unsophisticated database users have in mind when thinking about transactions. So they do that because of benchmarks, they want to look good, and they cannot use serializable, but this would have been correct in serializable isolation. That's just one remark. I don't know what you think about that. And the other is, why aren't error codes like specified in SQL like the rest of what you do with the database?
Those are both good questions. I've never operated a database in anything other than read and committed, so I don't know. The trade-off is between consistency and sort of speed, right?
Yeah.
Like if you have serializable, you might lock the entire table, right?
I mean, if you write a database, you should default to the safest setting, and then you like downgrade if you know what you're doing.
Yeah, it's about what's good enough, you know. it's tough. What was I going to say? To your other question, I don't know. I don't know why they didn't implement the error codes in SQL or in the SQL spec.
Hi, there was an earlier question about APIs that kind of made me wonder, this thinking about database transactions and consistency, have you seen examples of API services deal with these analogous issues rigorously? You know, like if you're calling an API and you do the same sort of steps with an API, maybe we should be thinking about APIs like we think about database consistency.
Yeah. I guess the analogy for an API would be like starting a transaction or updating multiple records at once. And that's tricky. I mean, most APIs tend to focus on is like a single object, you know, and like doing actions on that object. I don't know. It's tough. You know, you hope that whatever it's doing behind the scenes is consistent and correct for your sake and for theirs, I guess. But yeah, I don't know. If I have any great examples, sorry. I mean, I guess you do see client libraries that like require you to pull down a resource and then update it. And they kind of use the same active record pattern even though they're talking to an API, which I don't really recommend. Like you should just issue an update the same way against the API and then you'll get a resource back and you can do whatever with it. And client libraries, you can choose to write your own or, you know, whatever, but.
Awesome. So true story, I used to work with a very nice Rails developer, but I used to think that just because an attribute was name ID, it meant primary key. So that was funny. So let's give it up for Kevin.
Thank you.
Introduce our main speaker. Her name is Caitie, if you haven't met her before, and I will tell you a little bit more about her. Caitie is a backend brat and distributed systems diva at Twitter. Prior to that, she built large-scale services and systems that power the entertainment industry at 343 Industries, Microsoft Game Studios, and HBO. While at 343 Industries, she partnered with the Extreme Computing Group in Microsoft Research to productionize Orleans as part of her work rewriting the Halo services. She gave credits. She has credits on several video games, including Gears of War 2, Gears of War 3, Halo 4, and Halo 5. Is there a Halo 6? No.
I don't know that I'm allowed to answer that question.
Okay, so she can't say anything about that. It may or may not be a Halo 6 in the works. Let's talk a little bit about Caitie's education. Caitie has a bachelor's in computer science from Cornell University and a master's in animal psychology that has deeply influenced how she thinks about systems and engineering-driven organizations. She has a book coming up about that topic. So let's give it up for Caitie.
So I'm super excited to be back at Papers We Love. This is honestly one of the most fun places I get to speak, so I like you guys. I got to speak at the first Papers We Love I spoke at, or the first one in San Francisco, was 2 years ago, right after I'd moved down here. So it's been like my 2 year anniversary in San Francisco, which is kind of cool. So it's been a ride. So we're going to talk about, this is my ode to Barbara Liskov, who I think probably most of you know her. She like won a Turing Award and invented like a lot of core things that some dude on Hacker News decided was like, why everyone knows these things. Like, why did she win a Turing Award? She invented them. But I'm going to talk today actually about a paper that I think is actually less well known from her work, and actually I think very undercited. So we're going to go through what Liskov's vision for how we should be doing distributed computing was. And so the paper I linked you to is from the Communications of the ACM from 1988, but we'll dive into that. Also, I'm a super Barbara Liskov fangirl, so you'll get that throughout the rest of this talk. This is me. I think Inez like basically read everything I've ever done, so that's cool. That's where you can find me on the internet. I like talking to people on the internet. Talk to me. And I work at the Twitters, which is cool, on distributed build infrastructure. So the paper. So this was published in the CACM, like I said, in 1988. And the goal of this paper was basically, it's sort of like a technical report. So if you did read it, there's not a ton of meat in terms of the actual implementation details, because those are in later things. This was more to express like an opinion about how we should be doing distributed programming in the future. So she developed this programming language called Argus. It's built on top of Clue, where a lot of her other original programming language research was done. And the goal of this was to support the implementation, the efficient implementation and execution of distributed programs. So the goal was to provide core key abstractions that will help developers deal with the idea that there's like partial failure and asynchrony and all this stuff. So we're going to go through that. But first, I want to start with the references. I actually read references in papers. Well, I read the abstract and then I read the references, usually to see if I care. But I just want to point this one out because I think this references section is super great. So you have like, you know, this Jim Gray paper on notes on database operating systems, because that's like super seminal in 1978. So you probably get an idea that we're going to talk about something with transactions. There's this other one that is actually a case study that they built a non-toy project. It's still a research project, but a non-toy project on top of Argus if you want to like dive deeper into how you would actually go and implement something on this system if you care. And then we get to the L section, which is cool because it's like a Liskov paper, which is the overview of the Argus language and systems, published in 1984. We get Liskov et al. For the Argus reference manual, published in 1987. We get Liskov et al. And in proceeding from SOSPI, another paper that implementation of Argus in 1987. Again, we get another Liskov paper that is basically abstraction and specifications in distributed systems or in programming languages in 1986. Another Liskov paper on linguistic support for robust distributed programs, and then this other one on abstraction mechanisms in Clue, which was her other language. So this is cool to like cite yourself six times in a report in the CACM, so that's kind of like life goals. But also I think it's worth pointing out that like the reason there are this many citations from her own work is that she was solving an unsolvable problem, or a problem that no one had really tried to solve before, right? She was charting new territory, and so this is the culmination, like a technical report that culminated about 10 years worth of work. The other one that's interesting is this is a dissertation, which I've actually read half of, on nested transactions, which we'll get to. It's really important in Argus that one of her grad, this is Liskov's grad student, did this in 1985. And then finally, you know, she cites herself a seventh time. She's not the main author on this paper, so I guess it's down in the W's, but it's implementation of resilient atomic data types. So basically, if you get to cite yourself seven times in a CACM report that you wrote, you're pretty much a diva, and that's all that there is to say about that. Okay, but what is Argus? So basically she justifies Argus, and this is from one of the other papers that that's cited called Guardians and Actions, which I'll supplement some of the talk with a lot more detail from these other papers. But they start on the introduction saying, you know, technological advances have made it cost effective to construct large systems from collections of computers connected via networks. To support the systems, there is growing need for the effective way to organize and maintain distributed programs. So we're back. When she started this work in the 80s, there's what, like 100 nodes on the internet, maybe? But I think it's cool because she's actually justifying this not because, like, Barbara Liskov's research is always very practical, and I find that really endearing as, like, an industry practitioner, where she tries and goes and solves problems that actually really matter. Like, now it's possible to, like, build these larger scale applications, so we should try and make something to help people do this. So at Argus's core, it's built around two fundamental concepts that she believes are the correct ways to build distributed programs. Argus is incredibly an opinionated system. RPC, so the remote procedure call, and atomicity. So we'll go through how she defines them in this paper and how this manifests itself in the language Argus. So the remote procedure call is basically, she says this quote, "We believe that the most desirable form of communications is the paired send and reply." Chris Micklejohn basically cries every time he reads this, but I digress. He doesn't really like RPC and loves Barbara Liskov. But basically what she's going on here is she's not advocating for the normal remote procedure call thing, which is a unified model of local and remote distributed programming. It's mostly she's just talking about like when we have to send a message across the wire, the best way to think about doing that is I make a request and I get a reply from the person I sent it to. And this is in contrast to like an async message where I might send it and you might not necessarily send me a response. Okay, so it's also incredibly opinionated where she says we're gonna use the remote procedure call and this language is gonna provide at most one semantics of these remote procedure calls. So that's also very important going on. She believes this is the correct way to build systems so that you don't have to reason about concepts like idempotency and things like that. Okay, so how does RPC manifest itself in Argus? Argus is built on this core concept of a guardian. And a guardian is a special kind of abstract object whose purpose is to encapsulate a resource. So this is basically a service in today's language. This is a service. Guardians are these abstract objects. We're in like the heyday of object-oriented programming, so that's why everything's like an object in this paper. It's an abstraction over the machine that the code is basically running on. And so this is sort of like one of the first papers that starts doing that. They want to basically say, like, we want to limit what a programmer has to reason about to be a certain piece of data or a certain object, and then we have a guardian built around that to deal with that. Each guardian can reside at a single node. Multiple guardians can reside on the same node. So once again, we're abstracting the code that is running in like a service away from the machine. They don't use that language in the paper because like that wasn't common language then. And then guardians are created dynamically, and the clutch here, or the kicker that kind of sucks, is the programmer specifies the physical node at which to create a guardian. So if you want to like instantiate a guardian, on some specific machine, you have to say like go do that. But that's basically like a config file today, so it's really not that big of a deal. Or like Puppet, you would set Puppet to do this, right? Okay, and then the other big thing is guardians have handlers, and handlers are sort of, you can think of them like an API. It permits its resource to be accessed by means of special procedures called handlers. Basically APIs. We didn't really have the term APIs at this point, so we're sort of inventing it here. Handlers are accessed via RPC. The important thing to note about these handlers, and what is different even if the guardians are running on the same machine, is that guardians can't affect each other's state. And so all the arguments and responses are passed by value to these handlers, and that way, like, you can't, it's not a reference, so you can't, like, modify shared memory and, like, screw each other up somehow there. The guardians are totally isolated from each other. The only, like, public access into the state of the guardian is via a handler. So in the paper, she goes through a banking example in Argus, and so this is, like, back in the 80s, so we're dealing with sort of, like, I'm writing an application for a teller who's going to sit at a terminal, and you're going to tell me to do things, and the teller's going to enter all this into the system. So the way they break this down is you have a guardian per branch. So if you knew you had a branch in San Francisco and a branch in Seattle, you'd have like instantiated guardian for each of them. You'd provide these methods, open on an account, close an account, deposit money into an account, withdraw money from an account, and like total, which is supposed to be like sum all of the money in the branch. So that's for like accounting purposes. And so basically, you know, here's an example of we have our two guardians, branch A and branch B, and if the teller was like interacting with people and needed to deposit money, open an account and deposit money, these would be the API calls you would make. And it's pretty simple, right? We're not doing anything cross branches. We're not talking about actually replicating the data. At this point, stuff was like, they were sort of like, the hardware was kind of reliable enough most of the time, although that starts to get questioned a little bit. But if we stored two disks, we didn't expect that to just like go poof. So that's sort of the basic information, and we'll get to the more interesting things in a second. So the second core concept is atomicity, and this is also a very opinionated thing, but this is sort of where it's really interesting, because Argus actually tries to provide consistency constraints in a language, like very, very strong consistency constraints in a language, so that like the developer doesn't have to worry about them. You get them for free. So Liskov says, an adequate language must provide a modular, reasonable, automatic method for achieving consistency. And so in Argus, they basically choose atomicity because of all of these horrible things that can happen in a distributed system, which is like concurrency, potential interfering activities, system failures, node crashes, network disruptions. So we want to make all of the activities in this system atomic. And an activity in Argus is... basically a set of events. So this actually goes back to, I think, your question where you were asking, like, what happens if we, like, thought about the API as encapsulating some form of strong consistency? So Argus is basically saying you would define a handler that would say, like, do a thing, like, and we'll go through an example. And it can chain multiple of these handler calls on multiple guardians that happen to listen on different machines, and these will all appear atomic. So like I said, actions are atomic, like, and so we get ACID. They're totally serializable, and they appear either they totally commit or they abort, and you never see intermediary states. So this is a really, really strong guarantee. This is something like an RBDMS provides you, but I think this is stronger because most of them are actually set to not be totally serializable for performance reasons out of the box. But anyway, So this is a super opinionated way to do things, but it is a very strong form of consistency that does kind of make the world easier to reason about, because you don't have to think about, like, oh, like, you know, I started assigning a driver to something, but then they, like, went somewhere else or whatever, as Kevin was referring to when you start interleaving requests to the database. The way Argus implements this atomicity is by defining atomic objects. They define this atomic abstract data type. And so Argus provides some out of the box, but it's also an abstract data type, so you can go and implement your own should you want to or need to. But it provides things like arrays, records, characters, integers, any kind of scalar type you can make atomic very easily in Argus. And guardians can use these atomic objects with their state. So anything that they think will be like access concurrently, that you want to make sure that you have these really strong consistency guarantees, you make them atomic. You can also have like normal objects, because Liskov is very practical and notes that, you know, like performance cost of synchronization is high. And so you don't want to do it on everything, you just want to do it when you need to. So the locking rules is super simple. It's read, write, lock, right? So multiple readers are allowed on an atomic object. Readers exclude writers, and writers exclude other writers and readers. So that's, everyone's, I think, fairly familiar with the read, write, lock, so that's not super crazy. And then basically this quote goes through, you know, computation in Argus stops as a top level action at some guardian. So like a bank teller would say, hey, branch guardian, like do a withdrawal, a money transfer, and we'll actually go through an example of that, and they would implement that in, and that would be some handler on a guardian. And then that guardian would go and compose a series of calls that might, of handler calls, that might involve multiple guardians, and then Argus would actually take care of doing all of this for you. You just define something very, very simple that says, like, this is what I want to do, and Argus ensures all of these guarantees under the hood. So how does this work in Argus, right? So like, let's go back to our teller example. We have branch A and branch B, and we want to implement some kind of transfer, but we want transfers to work between branches. So now we essentially have a distributed transaction. And so what is actually going to happen is you're going to define a top level action, which is a transfer action. And the two calls we're going to do, which are called sub actions, everything sort of breaks down into like a tree for these actions hierarchies in Argus. And we're going to deposit to the one account, and we're going to withdraw from the other account the same amount of money, right? And so this is the code that you would write, and what it actually really looks like, and this might be a little bit wrong, but this is sort of what Argus looks like programming language-wise from what I could infer from the paper. So as a programmer, you're like, okay, I have to define this transfer method. So I would say enter top action. Co-enter means you can do things in parallel. So like when you have sub-actions, they can run in parallel. But parents can't run at the same time as sub-actions for consistency reasons. And so you would say branch A, deposit into account 1, 2, 3, $50. And from branch B, withdraw from the account 789, $50. And now we have a consistent system if this executes atomically, right? You can also, obviously, I think in the paper they go through like how you would like do the lookup and make sure that these things don't move around as you're going, because you could run into a race of like, oh, I looked up branch A, and it's not in the action, and then like branch A could move, and that would be problematic, perhaps. But I sort of just like simplified it for brevity here. So what is Argus actually doing? You wrote that code, and now Argus is going to go under the system, go do this for you. So what it's going to do is, these are three nodes, you can say, in the system, or three different guardians. And it's going to say send the deposit RPC to branch A, and it's going to send the withdrawal RPC to branch B. It's then going to take, our accounts are atomic objects, right? So it's then going to take in a lock. It has to acquire a lock on these atomic objects before it can make any kind of progress, because we're limiting access. And it's going to acquire a write lock, because both of these RPCs are going to modify the state of the account. So it's going to acquire a write lock at branch A and at branch B. And once it does that, it will then modify the accounts. And the way it does it's to ensure that you can always roll back, it uses a versioning strategy that it keeps in volatile memory. So it will actually version the object instead of overwriting it, because then you could roll it back. This is pretty typical of how like transactions work. Nothing super crazy here, where we add the $50 and remove it from the other account. We still hold the lock, and then we return to the top level guardian. We respond to our RPC that, hey, the deposit was successful and the withdrawal was successful. And so now the guardian that ran the top level action, both of our sub actions have committed. So we're going to go to our top level action. It's going to run around a two-phase commit. And so the way it does this is to ensure to basically now we have to tell everyone, like, actually go commit. We finished everything in all of our sub actions. So it's going to start in two-phase commit. Two-phase commit has two phases. It's aptly named. And phase one is generally the prepare phase. So you're going to say to all of the guardians involved, or sorry, all of these sub-actions which have guardians involved, it's going to say, hey, go prepare yourself. Like, we're going to commit this action totally across the entire system. And so at this point now, each guardian has to write its version to stable storage. It's not actually, and the reason it needs to do that, because if branch B crashed for some reason in between the prepare and commit phase, because at this point anyone could say, like, no, I don't want to do it, and you would still have to abort the whole transaction. So it's basically ensuring all the locks are still held, because if something crashed in between, we lost the volatile memory update, and it's going to record the new state, this V1 state, to stable storage. Then they're both going to say, like, cool, like, yeah, let's do this. And so then the coordinator that's running this action is going to say, hey, everyone commit. And so then at this point, all of the locks are released once they process this commit message, and the stable version is updated with that update version. And so now, like, other transaction or other handler calls can proceed in the system because we've released the lock, and everyone will see this version of 150 and 200. No one has ever seen some weird intermediary state where, like, account 789 had 250 and account 123 had 150. That doesn't happen. So all of our, like, accounting things, where if we ran total, would all see a consistent state. We wouldn't see money added or lost anywhere in the system. So that's cool. Just in a distributed system, you have to say it succeeded for commit. And the top level action has to hang around and wait until basically every guardian involved in the system commits, because otherwise, like, if you don't get it committed, then you don't know it did it, and so it'll just sit there and keep pinging the ones that haven't responded that I committed yet until it does, which is one of the problems with 2PC, because it sort of can flood your network if things are bad. But anyway, if all goes well, then we're done. And we have a distributed transaction that just happened, and all I did was write, like, four lines of code, which is cool. Okay, so let's go really quick through how it deals with failures. Say we did the same thing. Even if they're on the same machine, Argus is going to treat them like a distributed transaction because it doesn't really know. And so say, obviously you couldn't deduct, let me go back to the money. You couldn't deduct $100 from account 456 because that would, like, be negative $50, which your bank probably won't let you do. So that handler is just going to say, like, no, you can't do this. It's going to abort and respond to the RPC and say abort. Like, I don't want to do this thing, abort. And so even the other one did say the deposit was successful and is holding its lock and it has made a volatile version in memory. The other one is release the lock because, like, we're not going to do it. We're not going to proceed forward. So there's no reason to continue to hold the lock. And now we're at the top where, like, we have to go through 2PC or abort. And so basically it just says abort the deposit to everyone involved, and it'll discard its version that it made in memory and release its lock and then say, yep, I did it. And then we're still in a consistent state. We weren't able to do the thing that we wanted to do, but that's okay because we maintained all the consistency guarantees in our systems. Okay, so this might seem a little... this is the thing I noted before. Argus allows actions to be nested. Basically, you can have actions can have one or more sub-actions. So I only showed you, like, two actions happening in here. Where this gets super interesting is if you start thinking of actions as being composable things. So say I wanted to replicate my state to not just be on one single machine. And I'm going to write this replicate function in Argus that says, because you can pass in guardians and handlers to other functions. So they're like first class citizens in a language, sort of like functional programming. So you can make a replicate action that says, that took in two guardians and a handler routine to call to replicate a request throughout the system. And because everything happens atomically, you know that the broadcast happens atomically and we don't get into these weird consistency issues like a NoSQL database might, where you need quorum and all of these things to fix and having to fix stuff up in the background. Obviously this has drawbacks, but that's what Argus gives you. So now I've defined this thing and I want to add it to my banking thing, my banking deposit transfer with deposit and withdrawal, because we want to make sure that if the hard drive crashes that holds your account information, that we don't, like, lose it. So now it's like I've written this one sub action or this one little tree, and I can compose it with this other one, and now it starts getting really powerful. So you can start seeing how you could build up really large distributed transactions and reuse code. And so So the interesting thing about this is it starts getting a little nutso with how locks are held. So basically, you'll go down the subaction of this tree, and I'm only going to explore one side for this example. But say it's going to deposit, it'll modify the state, it'll make its volatile in-memory version. It's going to replicate the deposit, so it's going to try to write it to two additional replicas, like replica A and replica B, like just do the same action there. And because Argus provides these at most once semantics, it's actually really powerful. If something either happens or you know for sure it didn't happen, we can successfully do this and start walking down the tree. And say replica B is down, it's crashed, and it can't replicate the deposit there. So then what happens is it says, okay, I want to abort the thing I tried to do. It's going to, that RPC is going to be returned to its parent action. It's then going to say, its parent is then going to have to, is it in charge of aborting everything below it? And this is more of a performance optimization, just because otherwise you'd be holding onto these locks until everything propagated all the way back up. And obviously you don't need to hold them if we're aborting the transaction, we just need to go back to stable state. So it'll say, hey, you other subaction, abort. This actually is a best effort thing, and then there's a whole nother crazy Barbara Liskov paper that defines the protocol with how they clean this up should this abort actually not happen, because it doesn't wait for it to happen. Undistributed garbage collection, it's cool, go read it. But I'm not gonna go into that because I don't have time to go through all of Barbara's wonderful things. But anyway, like, let's pretend that actually aborted. It's gonna release its lock, and then like this whole thing will propagate all the way back up the stack. And like undo the state that it modified, and then we get to the top level and it'll do the abort. And so this is super powerful, right? Because we have at most one semantics, we have serializability, so it makes it really easy to reason about a program. You don't have to deal with all these weird edge cases. The other cool thing is that Argus is like, you know, dog foods itself essentially. It runs every handler call as a subaction. This extra action ensures that the calls have zero and one semantics. It also allows you to do things like, if it doesn't matter which node you're going to, because you're talking to like a stateless guardian and there might be multiple of them, and you just need to like ask one of them for an answer, it also allows you to say like, hey, maybe this first one I tried failed, let me try this other one. So that's super simple, like similar to ideas in like gRPC and Finagle, where it like tries to find a node in the system to answer your request and will handle retries for you automatically, which is really nice. So Argus sort of does this if you want to go and implement that. So that's super cool. Okay, so now we get to the audience participation part of this talk. What do you think happens if subactions try to access the same atomic object? Any good? Well, you don't release the locks until the top. Deadlock? I heard deadlock. Yeah? So Argus has reentrant locks, which is super crazy, but comes from this dude's dissertation on nested transactions. And so this is to prevent the idea that when you're starting to chain all these things together, you are easily going to deadlock yourself if you didn't have reentrant locks, right? And so this makes it a little easier, and we'll go through the rules of that, which you started to state. So a read lock, if your parent holds a read lock, and you try to access it, and you're an ancestor of the person who holds that lock, you can read, because there's no conflict there, right? Like, we're seeing the same data in the same transaction, fine. The right one is a little nuts, but it works, and there are many, many proofs. There's actually one written by Nancy Lynch about how this works. But basically, the idea is all holders of the right locks on X must be ancestors of S. And the reason this works on object S must be ancestors of the action that's trying to access this. And the reason this works is because of the hierarchy in the tree and the fact that Argus doesn't allow different sections of the sub-actions in the tree to execute at different times. There's a proof, if you care, go read it. It takes a minute to think about it, I think. Anyway, it's also interesting, basically it says, sub-actions have their own softer form of commit or abort. They're still not visible to the outside world. But within the tree, it goes through a commit and abort. So when you commit as a subaction, your parent will acquire your lock, basically. So if S holds a write lock, you will acquire that write lock even if you have a weaker lock. And this is to maintain consistency throughout the system. On abort, you just discard your locks and like move on. like we did before. So we're going to go through a quick example just to give you some intuition about this on a very easy, easy example. If you want to see really crazy examples, go read that dude's PhD thesis. It's like, it took me a long time and hurt my brain, but it works. So basically what you do is say we wanted to implement a transaction that did some kind of compound interest at the bank. But for whatever reason, we don't want people to see like multiple deposits of interest. We just want them to see it like all at once. So we're going to run this as a transaction. My first sub action is going to add 1.5% interest to my account. My second sub action is going to add 2% interest to my account. And this action Z is actually going to read my account balance, see if you have a certain amount of money. And then if you do, we'll add an additional amount of 0.5% interest to the account because it's like some promotion the bank ran, whatever. So we start with our original state. We're going to go execute action X. It's going to acquire a write lock on this object, which is your account balance. It's going to like modify it, add the interest, create a version. Note that it holds the write lock. So I didn't show you this before, but it does actually know who holds the lock. And this is super important for nested transactions. So then Y is going to come in and try and execute and say, oh, I need to add 2% interest. It looks at the fact that X had the write lock, and so it says, cool, X is my parent. I can acquire a write lock on this, and it creates another version. And the reason you have to create all these versions is at any point you can roll back. And Argus also supports that even if like Y rolled back, it doesn't mean that X necessarily has to roll back if the programmer wants to implement some conditional logic to say like, not everyone below me has to succeed for the top level action to succeed, which is cool that there is that flexibility in the system. So we're going to keep going, and now we're going to get to Z, which just needs to acquire a read lock, and it totally can because all of the locks held are currently by my parents. Even if they all happen to be write locks, that's not a problem because they're my parents. And so it's going to say, like, yes, your balance is over $100, so we're going to give you this extra interest. I'm going to spawn another sub-action to go do this. It's going to add 0.5%. It's going to come in. Look, I can acquire this lock because all of the lock holders are my parents. And then you have this top level. So now we go through this partial commit thing that happens in Argus where W is going to say, okay, I want to commit. And so that's cool. So its parent Z has to inherit its lock. So Z used to hold a read lock, but now it holds a write lock because if there was other things happening in this transaction for consistency reasons, it has to hold a write lock. Okay. And then we keep rolling up the stack. So now like Y inherits the lock that it's looking at version 3. So then anyone after it who would acquire the lock would see version 3. Any of its other children if it happened to have any. And so on and so forth till we get to the top where X is like, yep, I want to do this. Like, and we're at the top level action. So run two-phase commit and everyone will commit. And we'll sort of like, you know, do the thing where we write to stable storage and we'll update the stable version to 208.10. I think you can actually not like also collapse the versions as you go, but I'm not 100% sure of that. And the papers that I read, I didn't read the implementation of Argus manual because it's like 100 pages, but would get into that if you so cared to see if you could make that performance optimization. So I showed you the safest thing that is correct. But anyway, so now we've committed. No one saw any of the intermediary states. That's cool. Like I showed you on the code before, this is not a lot of code. This is like normal conditional code. This is actually sort of getting at what Ruby tried to provide you, but it's actually enforcing a much stronger guarantee. Okay, so this is neat, but there are problems with Argus, right? Like why don't we just all program in this today? Deadlocks are a huge problem in Argus, and Liskov actually says this in basically every implementation that she writes to correspond with these papers. She basically says all the toy programs trivially deadlock that she writes for the papers. And so, if you had a large concurrent system, you could obviously go, and she does explain sometimes about what you could do to like make it not deadlock. But basically, she's passing the burden, and Argus doesn't like detect deadlocks in the code. Like, there's no compile time check for deadlocks. Stuff will just time out, and then it'll like all abort. But that's obviously problematic when you have these really long composable sub actions that cascade all over your distributed system, because like deadlocks are a real thing. So this is like not a solved problem, but I think basically what she's getting at here is that. She says programmers must think about deadlocks and starvation and implement the code to avoid them when possible. And so this sort of goes against that, like, we're being super friendly to the programmer and you don't have to think about all these distributed systems problems, because now you have to think about deadlocks, which I think are incredibly hard to reason about, especially when you start talking about composing a bunch of code. I think her take on this, basically, if I understand it correctly, is basically deadlock detection is a solvable problem for machines. And so there would be, like, future work if this was the right path to go down, that we would write code that would solve deadlock detection and make it easier for us to not deadlock, so it wouldn't be a programmer problem. Argus also basically has this thing where every time you make a handler call on a guardian, it spawns off a new process so that you can execute multiple requests concurrently, because it's the whole purpose of doing this distributed system is we want to have high availability and high concurrency in the system. Obviously, this is pretty expensive, and if you run on a single processor node, which, like, you know, back in the 80s was like a thing, then only one of your processes will be running at a time. And so everything was synchronous back then, right? We didn't have asynchronous calls. We just, like, would make a synchronous request, and it would block until it responded. And that kind of sucks and, like, is a huge performance problem. But, like, if you're Barbara Liskov, you're just like, whatever, I'm going to invent this solution to this problem. So she invented promises, if you don't know that. And she published this in 1988. So basically all of async programming. I'm going to go back to this GIF because I just like it. I'll play. Nope. Yeah. So this is, like, basically how I interpret Barbara Liskov when she just looks at all of us. And she's like, unsolvable distributed system problem. Yeah, okay. So she published this. And this is obviously hugely foundational. And this is, I think, a very heavily cited paper. This is, like, day-to-day. Like, we use this with futures and promises and Finagle and gRPC. And, like, basically the world we live in today operates on the fact that you can make you can make network calls without blocking a thread anymore, which is cool. Okay, so where do we go from here, right? Like, Argus is super cool and super influential, but it obviously has these problems. And, like, why did we build all of this, right? So this is a super opinionated system. Oh, before we get to that, guardians basically, I think, is super important, and people don't make the connection enough that we've now decomposed our systems into units of tightly coupled data and processing, and that sounds a lot like microservices. So, like, Barbara Liskov invented microservices. But, like, so this was, like, that idea of, like, how do we start? A lot of her work is basically, like, how do we make the task of running stuff on computers, which is, like, weird and, like, hard for the human brain to reason about, into something that is more reasonable and understandable for the human brain to reason about. And so it's, like, how do we create abstractions that make sense? And, like, how do we create the right abstractions that help people just think about the problem they're trying to solve? So a guardian is a microservice, essentially. And she also talks about things like service discovery in these papers. She doesn't call it that, but it's basically like how you would have a build a registry to look up where all these things lived, service discovery. And you know, retrying requests automatically for you. So all of these nice things that we sort of have today in our RPC frameworks, like gRPC and Finagle, like basically Liskov, I think, seeded those ideas, and they are not recognized to come from her enough. But basically, at the end of the day, she built this entire system because at her core, and she still does today based on the story that Christopher Mickeljohn told me from meeting her at Heidelberg Laureate Forum, is that, you know, atomic actions are an important tool for both understanding what a system should do and for implementing it correctly. She very much takes the stance and does not back down on the stance that asking programmers to reason about systems without strict serializability is a no-go. It's not a thing to do. But obviously this is problematic from availability constraint, right? Because the more strong concurrency you offer, the more actions we allow people to arbitrarily chain together, the longer that's going to take on the system, the longer you have to hold locks. That's a real bottleneck for performance. So I worked on this program called Orleans. This tech report was published in 2014, and Orleans had basically the totally opposite take. And I meant to bug Sergey about, like, did he read Argus? Was he familiar with the work? Did this inspire it? Sergey's the guy who, like, you know, came up with the idea for Orleans and developed it, and I worked very closely with, and he's awesome. But Orleans has a totally different take, and it focuses on the availability side. And what I thought was super cool reading Argus, which I read after I worked on this project, was it uses a lot of the same concepts. Orleans is built on the actor model, so you have these objects that basically run and they define APIs, and you can only interact with them with async messages, but Orleans, for the most part, the golden path turns that into an RPC, so that's like a Liskov idea. You have these things that are self-contained. They're a little smaller in Orleans because they're actors, but they're basically really tiny guardians. But we don't have strong consistency. We sort of leave that all up to the developer. So, like, when we wrote Halo Services, these are all grains or actors in Orleans, but you could very easily translate this to Argus and think of them as guardians. This is our stats service. Basically, like, you would upload stats from playing Halo. We would store them. We would store, like, a total record of the game, and then we would have, like, every player had an actor in the system, and it would do its own stats and then store them because people had, like, a ton of stats. But that's the short version of what's happening. And you could totally, this is analogous to Argus. You could implement this in Argus, and then I wouldn't have had to done, like, crazy feral concurrency to make this all work and be idempotent and, like, write weird shit. So, like, that would have made my life easier, but it also probably would have made Halo less available, because if you're writing stats, you can't read your current, like, armor loadout, and that would be problematic if it didn't let you play the game, and people get really whiny about that. So that's why I was, like, super excited Kevin was doing feral concurrency, because it's basically, like, we've made this availability trade-off so hard in industry today that we go and implement our own feral concurrency control models, and, like, we sometimes get it wrong because it's actually just really hard. Or we're providing an abstraction. Like, my take on the feral concurrency paper is that I think the fact that Ruby calls things transactions that are not actually serializable transactions is the biggest problem in Ruby. Because you're providing a concept to developers who are used to thinking of transactions of having ACID, atomicity, isolation, serializability, and it's not actually providing that. And so if you understand that as a developer, it's totally fine. But if you don't, you're conflating a term that means a specific thing with something that it doesn't mean, and so that's confusing, and that's, like, no one's fault. But so this is why, like, API design and abstract data types are really important. Kevin already talked about this. Basically, like, they focus their study on the common use of a feral or application level mechanism for maintaining database integrity, and so that's sort of the world I live in today. This is, like, literally all I do is I write for feral concurrency control mechanisms on top of key value stores. That's why they pay me money. So then you have other things in industry that are trying, or in research, that are trying to solve this problem from a different direction. Because I want to live in a world where, like, I don't have to think about consistency constraints so much. I want, like, help from my language or from my runtime to do this. And so LASP is this language that Christopher Mickeljohn works on, and it's based on this concept of CRDTs, which are conflict-free free replicated data types. So he's actually building a language around them that uses them. And the idea here is that based on the properties of CRDTs, you can actually just, like, update at a replica. And then, like, even if they're not connected, everything always merges together. This is a CRDT set. It's an add, remove set. So basically what's happening in the very, very short TLDR version of this is all of these updates are happening at different replicas. This is replica A, B, and C. They eventually propagate the state, but you can see they're not synchronizing in between. And at the end, we all merge to the exact same state. So that is what a CRDT gives you. It is totally mergeable state that is mathematically provable via these data structures. And so, like, I, as the programmer, don't have to care about, like, well, what if I update this? And then, like, someone else reads it and then, like, roll back this action. Like, no, like, it just works. The problem with LASP and CRDTs and sort of where a lot of this work is exploring is how much can you actually implement when you have no coordination. So this takes a totally opposite approach. It's totally available, but it doesn't give you any kind of strong consistency guarantees. And so that's really hard. So they're sort of exploring, like, how far can we push this? Can we get causal consistency? Is that enough? What are the levels of systems that you can actually build using this? And then we go back to Spanner, right? Like, maybe Liskov was totally right, because Google, with all of its engineers, who are incredibly smart, has basically said, like, yeah, distributed transactions are a thing we need to support because it's too hard to build systems without them. So they basically put atomic clocks and GPSs on every machine in their goddamn fleet so that they can run this and they can have distributed transactions. That's incredibly expensive. And also, like, I don't work at Google, so I don't get to use this, so I'm better. But not that I don't work at Google, but just that I can't use this. So, like, this goes back to Liskov's original premise. Like, they say they're the first system to support distributed data at global scale, blah, 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 whatever. Fine, like, maybe Liskov did not deploy this in data centers around the world, but she did build a system that could also do this and was a programming language, just saying they maybe should have cited her. anyway. And then what I think is super interesting, and this is sort of the last bit before I wrap it up, is there's tools that are coming out, like this one from Popple in 2016, this paper. It's called 'Cause I'm Strong Enough, or SISE, you'll hear it referred to. And what they're trying to do is help developers pick the right level of consistency you need, because they're very conscious, researchers are very conscious of the fact that you want availability, like that is king. This is the reason we've dealt with like MongoDB for like how many years. And it, as an industry, like that's super true. So what if we help people, right? A tool that helps people reason about the concurrency, where they need strong concurrency and where they don't, and then you can only like have to implement it where you need it. And so they basically write this tool. This is a super shitty code snippet, but it's what's on their website. This is in Java. You annotate Java to do a bank balance account, and you basically define these constraints and invariants that must hold about it. So what's actually happening here is that my balance must always be greater than zero. I can do debit and deposit on this account. It defines constraints on deposit. And basically, if you run the tool, it'll come up with the fact that you don't need any consistency on deposit or coordination on deposit, because you can always add a positive number to zero and get a non-zero number, or a zero or greater number, I should say. And so then if you go and do this again on debit, and you run it and you hold this account true, and you run SISE, it'll like give you an error and say you need coordination here, because you cannot safely do this without coordination, without checking the other replicas to see if there was an update that you missed. So I think this is cool, and this is a nice middle ground. So let's wrap it up, and this is where it's getting into like my opinion and not Barbara's. So I think serializable transactions are probably overkill for a large number of applications. Argus was truly novel at its time because it was the first language to try and provide some form of consistency control as a language primitive. And I'm a super huge advocate of this. Like, we should be trying to build this, and I like research that does this. On the flip side, languages like Lisp don't provide strong enough consistency to build most applications. They take the totally opposite approach and go totally available. What we need are languages that take these ideas and implement something in the middle. Or even better yet, integrate tools like SISE, which help developers pick the right level of consistency and then actually just go and do the correct consistency protocol for you behind the scenes. That is the world I would like to live in. I don't want to write conferral concurrency control algorithms anymore. So thank you. I'll take questions. That was like some hope for 2017, because it's going to go downhill tomorrow.
Hoorah. So a couple questions. I'll just list off a few things. Do you know of anything that does do deadlock detection currently? That's one. And then two, where does software transactional memory fit into this whole story? And also, am I understanding correctly that the deadlocks are abstracted away in Argus?
No, they're a very real problem that you have to deal with.
Yeah, okay.
So as far as I know in terms of deadlock detectors, like Golang has one for concurrency, but I don't know of any that work in production. Do you know one, Hodges? Do you want to say one? Oh, cool. So what's it called? Sanitizer?
Thread sanitizer. Yeah.
Thread sanitizer.
So yes, there's that. They're becoming popular because people are realizing it's like a real problem and trying to write something, but until like there's not a ton of options out there that I am aware of anyway.
And then STM?
So if I understand like transactional memory correctly, isn't that only for like concurrent threads on a single machine?
Well, there is a project in JavaScript that is implementing a distributed STM. So
I don't know about that. I know there's like RDMA and stuff, which is like, I'm not an expert on that. I think it is like kind of magic right now to me, and whatever. I don't know enough about that to have a real opinion. Yeah. So my comment on most of those is, how do you do versioning? Because they don't allow you to do that.
Okay, question here.
That's okay. Yeah.
Hey, great talk. I'd love to hear more about your thoughts on CRDTs, like namely whether you know of any large-scale system using them in production, or whether, like, I don't know, what's your opinion? Is this the future or not?
Yeah, so CRDTs are actually being used in production. So from that point of view, since the original paper was published in 2011 by Shapiro et al., it's like a widely successful research project. So like REOC, which is a database by Basho, uses CRDTs in production. They were a partner actually with a bunch of those people in something called ThinkFree. And then Riot Games has built their chat service on top of REOC, which makes use of those CRDTs. And then TomTom, actually there's a great talk from Strange Loop this year, or this past year, I should say, 2016, on how TomTom uses CRDTs in production to basically sync your settings between your different devices. CRDTs are still a little problematic, even if you can settle for the consistency constraints, because they're monotonically growing objects. So basically what you get, where everyone who implements them for real in like production I've ever heard, is they do a round of like Paxos essentially every now and then and like shrink the state and then like go back out, because otherwise it just like grows unbounded and that's bad. Yeah, is that in production? Sorry, that was a really dick thing to say. Is Docs CRDTs?
Yeah, Docs is not exactly CRDTs.
Yeah, so the reason I just call it the difference is because Martin Kleppman is actually working on a JSON version of CRDTs that he's building a doc application around. So they're doing something like yes, there are different ways to merge state, but like Docs, from what I understand, is not a true CRDT.
I have two questions. Or a comment and a question. First of all, just a quick comment about the software transactional memory. It would be cool, but also Intel has like released at least three different processors and they're all broken. Haswell and Broadwell transactional memory is completely broken. Cool. It just doesn't work. Question for you is, you mentioned the trade-off between availability and consistency, but there's two other trade-offs, which is performance and flexibility. And I think the most common reasons that people tend to opt for weaker concurrency models is performance, which is something you generally can't really win if you enforce this at the language level. I was curious, like, do you find that people tend to make this as a wrong trade-off, or is there a way you could gracefully degrade so that you start off with strong concurrency but gracefully, like, reduce the amount of consistency that you require in order to gain the performance? Or is it the right model is strong concurrency, and you need to build like your systems to be performant in face of strong concurrency?
So I think my take on that is, if I understand correctly, is, you know, like, yes, performance is a huge concern. She's actually pretty concerned with it in Argus too, which is great. I just think that the levels of concurrency we see today were not like a thing then. So we were looking at, you know, a couple transactions a second, maybe. I think the biggest problem is that the fact that you have to think about consistency as a developer is dumb. Like, we should be writing tools like Sizey, which, like, I don't think you can, like, make the trade-off. Like there are business constraints where, like, things can't be wrong. Like, if you work in finance, like, you have to, like, do things correctly, and that's why they have, like, 18 levels of audit trails, and they do a lot of this manual reconciliation is because, like there are laws and, like, contracts about, like, with money, there's contracts with, like media and like where you can show shows and like where you can see songs and things like that. So like those are things that are like very like legal reasons, like where you can't, your software should not be sat like, you know, selling things, like just be on this sliding window. I think what you really need are tools to help you better understand where you need the coordination in your system, because most solutions are very heavy handed. It's either like everything is strong consistency or everything is weakly available, and we don't have a lot of solutions right now that allow you to mix in the middle.
Well, so I had a quick question. So you started talking about an opinion around kind of fire and forget versus RPC, where you must have a response. I know from my personal experience, building systems that need transactional guarantees with fire and forget is pretty much impossible. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you've seen any examples where that actually works, or if RPC is really the only way to go for building like robust systems that need transactional guarantees.
Yeah, so I guess my comment more there is around async messaging versus RPC. So you can actually build RPC on top of async messaging. So like async messaging is a more, I guess my comment there is like async messaging is a more general model. So if you start there, like I think RPC makes sense. Like I'm actually on board with that. Orleans by default mostly does that. For performance reasons, when we were building Halo, we're like, can you give us a way to just like send a message and not have to wait for a response? Because that's like, if I don't care, I really, like there's times where I just don't care, right? And so like async messaging is also nice too, because then I can like send you a message and you can send like someone else a message and then they can respond to me. So you can start doing these forwarding things like more efficiently to some extent. So that's where my trade-off is. I don't know if you can do transactions without having a formal like send and response. I have no idea. That's intuition, that sounds right to me that you would need a send and response model.
Hi, I think you briefly touched about this. The two-phase protocol is unsafe, and as far as I know, and so, and Barbara gets around this by doing cleaning after, in case if this fails?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah, I can just, so there's another paper which is actually not one of the ones in her reference because she doesn't really talk about it in this. Let's go back to here. If you like go to her webpage, it's on there. Something about like distributed garbage custom. So this abort, oops, one more. Show the abort. This abort is actually not an RPC. Like she's, well, it is, but she sends it and if it doesn't make it, they like don't hold up the chain because they have like, they basically implement distributed garbage collection to free this lock later. Because the problem is it's holding a lock, right?
Okay. Curious if you have any take on event sourcing or CQRS type models and maybe a little bit orthogonal what you're talking about, but in terms of approaching concurrency that way or.
Yeah. So when you say CQRS, like, are you mean
command
like
query Kafka response?
Or like, yeah. So it's like
Apache SAMHSA.
Yeah, so basically what you're doing is you're throwing everything on a queue.
Right.
And this is actually an easy way to implement like CAS operations and stuff. You just pipeline everything. And then everyone, you're enforcing a total order on the entire system. So it's actually stronger. You get linearizability, which is actually a stronger guarantee that Argus provides. Because you've just like piped everything and enforced a total order, which is nice because it's really great. It's easy. If you can get away with that for performance reasons, like do it because it makes thinking about things way easier. I mean, like I'm not like a superhero, like thinking about like all like eventual consistency and like idempotency and like commutativity and like making my operations fit into that to like work is actually pretty hard. Like it's a, you know, you're doing like gymnastics with the business logic to make it fit into that model so that we know it works. If you can get away for scale reasons with just like, I mean like Uber uses Kafka pretty heavily to enforce a total order on everything that's happening and that works okay. Matt Rainey's not here, so I don't want to like say anything. But if you come and Matt Rainey's here, he'll ask him about Kafka at the bar, you'll get some really good stories. But it's just like, because they have such high throughput, they start having problems. Because of the fact that you enforce a total order, you start seeing lag in the system, it spikes.
Latency, yeah.
It's a trade-off, right?
Thanks.
All right. Thank you so much, Caitie.
Thanks.
Ooh.